Hi everyone, thank you for tuning in to Texas Black Diamond Entertainment. This is your girl, Texas Black Diamond. And I just want to throw Sony in because, you know, they throwing that rock and hiding their hand because somebody's worth almost $1 billion. And they are using these little fishes in the pond to help shake this man down. R. Kelly, Robert Sylvester Kelly. Look at some clips here and I will come back with some more. Please share this video.
Prince, whose full name was Prince Rogers Nelson, died April 21, 2016, at age 57 from an accidental overdose of the opioid fentanyl. CNN, Sony Music Entertainment announced Wednesday that it has signed an exclusive distribution agreement with Prince's estate for 35 previously released albums from the legendary musician's catalog. The music will be distributed by Legacy Recordings, a division of SME, with worldwide rights beginning immediately for 19 previously released album titles originally released between 1995 to 2010. Those album titles include The Gold Experience, 1995, Emancipation, 1996, Rave Unto the Joy Fantastic, 1999, The Rainbow Children, 2001, Musicology, 2004, 3121, 2006, and Planet Earth, 2007. Additional album titles from the 2014-2015 era will also be distributed with worldwide rights in the future. The agreement also includes rights to other previously released material that was recorded after 1995, including singles, B-sides, remixes, non-album tracks, live recordings and music videos. Beginning in 2021, Sony Legacy's distribution rights will be expanded to include 12 Prince non-soundtrack catalog albums, featuring tunes recorded by the artist from 1978 to 1996 for distribution in the United States. That time period includes the albums, Prince, 1979, Dirty Mind, 1980, Controversy, 1981, 1999, 1982, Around the World in a Day, 1985, Sign, Oh the Times, 1987, Lovesexy, 1988, Diamonds and Pearls, 1991, and Love Symbol, 1992, as well as hit singles, 1999, Little Red Corvette, I Wanna Be Your Lover, and Raspberry Beret. A true artist and visionary, Prince changed the world with his music, bringing love, joy and inspiration to millions, Richard Story, president, SME Commercial Music Group, said in a statement. Sony Music is honored to play a part in keeping Prince's music alive and making it available for generations of lifelong listeners and future fans.
Yeah! You know, let me just say this. The tradition of great performers from, and I really want you to hear what I have to say. The tradition of great performers from Sammy Davis Jr. to James Brown to Jackie Wilson to Fred Astaire, Gene Kelly. The story is usually the same though, you know, these guys work really hard at their craft, but the story ends the same. They usually are broken, torn, and usually just sad, and the story is very sad in the end, because the companies take advantage of them. They really do. And Sony being the artist that I am, at Sony, I've generated several billion dollars for Sony. Several billion. And they really thought that my mind is always on music and dancing, and it usually is, but They never thought that this performer, myself, would outthink them.
Yeah!
We can't let them get away with, with what they're trying to do, because now I'm a free agent.
Yeah.
I just owe Sony one more album. It's just a box set, really. It's with two new songs, which I've written ages ago. Because every album that I record, I write, like, literally, I'm telling you the truth, I write at least 120 songs every album I do. So I can do the box set and just give them any two songs. So I'm leaving Sony, a free agent. Owning half of Sony. So I own half of Sony's publishing, and I'm leaving them, and they're very angry at me because of it, but I just did good business, you know. So the way they get revenge is to try and destroy my album. Tony Mottola is a devil. After divorcing Tommy, came to me crying. She was crying so badly, I had to hold her. And she said to me that this is an evil man. And Michael, this man follows me, she said. He taps her phones. And he's very, very evil, and she doesn't trust him. And he is a horrible human being, and we have to continue our drive until he's terminated.
But see, everybody hollering about Conrad Murray. Michael was not paying Conrad Murray to do these things. There's other people that's involved, and Conrad Murray is just a fall guy. I mean, after justice, and I have to get all the guys that was treating Michael wrong. And it was more than just Conrad Murray.
The album's number one all over the world. All over the world. America's the only one because, I don't want to say too much.
But it's not number one in the United States.
It's conspiracy, yeah. I don't want to say too much. I'm done. I don't want to say
Michael Jackson were what we call enablers. They had a lot to gain from him and a lot to lose from him. He was dependent and ruled by others. And that really contributed to his demise.
He had ruthless people around him who found him to be extremely vulnerable.
They're all sycophants. They're parasites. Most of them financial parasites. He was surrounded by people who were just interested in how much money he can make for them.
Blacks. But when I say Jew me, sue me, everybody do me, kick me, kike me, don't you black or white me, I'm talking about myself as the victim. You know, my.
But I understand in 2005 you were with him and actually took him to a hospital at one point, correct?
Yes, that's right. That was the last week of the trial. And when I got a call from Joe and a message from his mother that I needed to come out and just take a look at him because they was worried about his demeanor. When I get there, I go to the trial. From there, we go back to Neverland. And he asked me to come upstairs, and he grabbed me and started crying, said, "Please don't leave me. They're trying to kill me." And I said, "When's the last time you ate?" He said, "No, they're poisoning me." I said, "Well, when's the last time you drank water?" And so one thing led to another. So I have a friend of mine that has this huge machine in L.A., Global Cardia Care. I said, "If you can bring this machine down," Michael's agreed to get on it. And they clamp you and they squeeze you and it'll print out everything in your body. And the only thing that it printed out was he was extremely dehydrated. Nothing wrong with his heart, nothing wrong with his lungs. And so the next day after we left court, I said, I need to take you to a hospital. He said, no, no, they'll kill me. And I said, well, let's do this. Let's let nobody know where we're going. Let me drive you up to San Francisco to a hospital that don't even know we're coming. He agreed to that. And then I said, look, 20 miles away from here, let's go to one of these hospitals. And we went to a hospital, and they examined him, and at 5:30, or a little bit before 6, they started intravenously putting liquid in him. At 6 o'clock the next morning, they were still putting water in him. And the doctor said to me, had he waited 12 more hours, he would have been dead.
What was going through your mind when you're taken into a police station in handcuffs to have a mugshot taken that you know is going to be shown around the world?
They did it to try and belittle me, to try to take away my pride. But I went through the whole system with them. And at the end, I wanted the public to know that I was okay, even though I was hurting.
What happened when they arrested you? What did they do to you?
They were supposed to go in and just check fingerprints and do the whole thing that they do when they take somebody in. They manhandled me very roughly. My shoulder is dislocated, literally. It's hurting me very badly. I'm in pain all the time. See this arm? This is as far as I can reach it. Same with this side over here.
Because of what happened at the police station?
Yeah, at the police station. And what they did to me, if you saw what they did to my arms, it was very bad what they did. It was very swollen, I want to say.
But how?
You'll see.
We were given this photograph said to be taken after Michael Jackson was released on bail. Jackson says the swelling above his wrist is where the police handcuffed him. How did they do it? I mean, what did they do?
With the handcuffs, the way they tied them too tight behind my back. Yeah, and they put it in a certain position, knowing that it's going to hurt and affect my back. Now I can't move. It keeps me from sleeping at night. I can't sleep at night.
And Jackson says there was more.
One time I asked to use the restroom, and they said, sure, it's right around the corner there. Once I went in the restroom, they locked me in there for like 45 minutes. There was doo-doo feces thrown all over the walls, the floor, the ceiling, and it stunk so bad. Then one of the policemen came by the window and he made a sarcastic remark. He said, does it smell good enough for you in there? How do you like the smell? Is it good? And I just simply said, it's all right. It's okay.
Conrad Murray's actions, Conrad Murray's omissions to act directly caused the death of Michael Jackson. Conrad Murray figuratively and literally abandoned Michael Jackson on June 25th, 2009.
Involved in this whole conspiracy. This is a conspiracy that we're dealing with. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people don't know that and understand it. They only know what the media feeds you, mm-hmm. as you well know, because we believe. See, the media is the eyes and ears to the world. Mm-hmm. Whatever they feed us is what we hear.
True.
And that's what we believe. And that's what the media is doing. Mm-hmm. I want the truth.
And what do you think is the truth, though? That there are other people involved,
yes,
and what else?
Well, Michael told me before he passed. He told me that he was afraid that he was going to die. He was going to be murdered, he said.
He thought he would be murdered.
Oh, yeah, he did. He said that to me.
Mm.
So homicide's a murder as far as I'm concerned. But the problem is that who did it?
Who actually did it?
Who manipulated this?
It might not be just one person, you're
saying. Oh, it's not one mm-hmm. person, no. Not at all.
Okay.
Voice, right. They think that he's feminine and so forth. Right. But I heard in real life he was not that at all.
Nah, Mike liked him.
Yeah.
He got it.
I remember
We actually had some real conversations. I got to know his type and all that. You know, he liked models, you know, tall, okay. slim models, you know what I'm saying?
So all the, you know, the pedophile and the gay stuff that came.
And I think all that was propaganda because Mike was doing such big things in the publishing world. I always felt like the music side, he was buying out a lot of great real estate.
The Beatles catalog?
A lot of stuff, and he wouldn't sell it back or wouldn't offer no options for it to be sold. And then, of course, his own catalog, there was a big fight around that. You know, I think what Michael was more about, it was power, because he was super smart and understood what real value meant to America. So he had access to a lot of American value, and he owned it. And if he didn't own it 100%, he owned it 50%. You know what I'm saying? Like, he owned a big chunk of America's value. That's the best way to put it. And at some point, you know, they're going to want to have the option to buy it back or control it to an extent. Mike just wouldn't allow it. And I think at that moment, that's when a lot of the propaganda and all this whispers and stuff start coming out about him, which was clearly not true.
I bought the Beatles.
Yeah.
While I'm doing the video with the Beatle. That's gangster.
Right.
With Michael Paul, Walker to Paul McCartney. You're going to sell the Beatles? How much you selling for? Oh, I don't know. You know, about $60 million. Wow, that's a lot of money. That motherfucker go right to his trailer and get his people on the phone. Paul don't find out till the next fucking day Michael done bought the Beatles. That motherfucker come on and say, how can you buy B.O.'s? How can you buy B.O.'s?
You say you wouldn't do it for all the money in the world.
I don't think so. If you show me the man, then I will sell him. If you ask me to lie, then I will tell him.
Diane, Beverly Hills police have put a hold on the autopsy results and refused to release the 9/11 tapes, the 911 tapes of the call from the Beverly Hilton Hotel here. But they have allowed the coroner's office to release Whitney Houston's body to her family this weeks before any kind of decision on the cause of death can be reached. The LA County coroner released Whitney Houston's body today, and she is on the way home to New Jersey on a private jet. The autopsy complete. Fluids taken for toxicology reports, but results not expected for at least 8 weeks. And while sources tell ABC News there were no signs of trauma or foul play on her body, no visible trace of illegal drugs, there were prescription bottles in the bathroom where Houston was found in the tub. And as seen in these photos obtained by TMZ, alcohol in the room, both champagne and beer. Still, that's not enough evidence for medical examiners to declare a definitive cause of death.
No matter what medications they're taking, until we run a tox and see the level and what's in the system, we're not going to speculate.
At the Beverly Hilton Hotel today, the singer's entourage moved out. Sources tell ABC News many are being questioned about Houston's last hours, but police insist this is not a homicide investigation. On Saturday, Houston talked by phone with her cousin and godmother Dionne Warwick and her mother Sissy, and minutes later, she went into the bathroom to prepare for a performance scheduled for the music business elite at Clive Davis's pre-Grammy party. She died alone, her body discovered by her entourage, submerged in the tub. She was not breathing, she had no pulse, and could not be revived. Coroner's investigators do know the types of drugs that were found inside the bathroom, the prescription drugs, including Valium and an antibiotic. What they don't know are the levels in her body, and that, of course, is key, Diane.
That's right, Jim. And with all these unanswered questions, I want to bring in ABC's chief health and medical editor, Dr. Richard Besser. Rich, 8 to 10 weeks until they have these tests released?
Well, that's a long time. The LA coroner's office told me 8 to 10 weeks is their standard practice. But I talked to medical examiners around the country, and they say the actual testing takes 2 to 3 days. Add a little time to double check that. Many say they will hold the results if there's a possible criminal investigation.
And how detailed are these results? Can you tell how recently she had what amount of alcohol or anything else?
You can tell some of that. You can tell, you know, the big causes of death, heart attack, stroke, where there's a clot to the lung. You can see if there's been alcohol consumption recently or cocaine use recently. Drug use that goes way beyond that, it depends on the particular drug.
Today, earlier, you were saying to me, when someone of her age dies in a bathtub, that is extremely unusual. Older people, younger people, perhaps, but we don't know if it was drowning, but the very fact of it is so unusual.
That's right. Those other groups will drown. Someone who's 48, it's very rare to see drowning unless there was something else involved.
Sony Music apologizes for price increase of Whitney Houston albums. Published by NME.com. Record label issues statement after the price of The Ultimate Collection and Greatest Hits was increased. Sony Music has apologized after it increased the prices of two Whitney Houston albums on Apple's iTunes store just hours after the singer's death. The singer passed away last Saturday, February 11, at the age of 48. She was discovered underwater and unconscious in a bath at a hotel in Beverly Hills, and, soon after news broke that she had died, the price of her albums, The Ultimate Collection, and Greatest Hits, were increased. The singer's, The Ultimate Collection, rose in price from £4.99 to £7.99 and, Whitney, The Greatest Hits also went up from £7.99 to £9.99. The price increase was in effect on the UK version of iTunes for a few hours on Sunday morning, February 12. Sony Music have issued a statement to Billboard.biz, which reads as follows. Whitney Houston product was mistakenly mispriced on the UK iTunes store on Sunday. When discovered, the mistake was immediately corrected. We apologize for any offense caused. Artists with multi-album exclusive deals to sue their labels. The impact on record labels was probably a collective sigh of relief that they could still recoup from their heavy investment in the artist's career. Although Michael sold over 100 million albums in the course of his career, he only recorded two albums of new material in two decades after the court case. He kept a brave face and made the best of it, but it ruined his career, said Wagnon. Michael remained conflicted about Sony until the end. His friend and musical collaborator David Austin told GQ magazine that 3 months before George Michael died, he turned around to me and he said how he wished he'd never taken Sony on in the first place. Because it dented the armor for his career in America. He was a guy that was firing on all four cylinders, and it just blew that candle out. But the stress and the strain. A year after George Michael's death, how singer's expensive legal battle with Sony changed the music industry. Published by MarketWatch.com. Was the late singer-songwriter right to take on record company in doom court case? Last Christmas is a holiday playlist season staple. But for George Michael, the song's composer and performer and one of the most renowned British singer-songwriters of the modern era who died on Christmas Day last year, his holiday season 25 years ago was likely especially fraught. The pop star had filed suit to sue his record label Sony Music Entertainment, owned by the Sony Corporation SNE, minus 0.86% in October 1992 in the London High Court, claiming restraint of trade and inequality of earnings and bargaining power. Ever since he rose to fame with the duo Wham!, Michael's music had been distributed by CBS. But after CBS got taken over by Sony in 1987, Michael felt he was being exploited by his label and, even though he had renegotiated his deal in 1990, felt increasingly despondent with his 8-album contract. Michael had enjoyed stellar success with 1987 album, Faith, but Sony took exception to the singer refusing to promote the follow-up record 1990's, Listen Without Prejudice, and refusing to appear in promo music videos. In turn, Michael strongly objected to the terms of his contract by which Sony possessed ultimate power of approval, being able to reject any material it did not like and prevent him from recording for any other label. The star, who did not come out as gay until his arrest for a lewd act in a Los Angeles lavatory in 1998, was further upset by Sony executives reportedly using homophobic slurs against him. George Michael's QC claimed in court that between 1987 to 1992, he had made worldwide profits of £7.35 million, $9.8 million, compared to Sony making £52.45 million, $70 million. According to Paul Russell, then Sony Music Europe president, on the first day the case reached court in October 1993, Michael said to him, "Well, one of us is going to have a happy Christmas," because he thought it would be over by then. In fact, the case lasted until June 1994 when Lord Justice Parker ruled the Sony deal was reasonable and fair. The case reputedly cost Michael £4 million, $5.4 million. The singer drew ridicule in the aftermath of his legal loss by saying the verdict amounted to professional slavery. Michael subsequently resumed his recording career in 1996 after signing a record deal with DreamWorks and Virgin, with Sony reputedly getting a 5% override. Even though George Michael ended up re-signing with Sony in 2003, the case continued to dwell on his mind. He told a BBC radio documentary, The Red Line, recorded shortly before his death and which was not made online due to rights restrictions, "I can honestly say I would do it again. The people in the industry thought, of course he's going to win. The contracts of the 1980s had been got rid of in the film industry in the 1950s, so why were they still there in the 1980s? It's the only industry on Earth that has no free agency. Michael added, any logical CEO would have thought, okay, he's going to do this. He'll get it out of his system. I would have given someone who had given them faith, a little respect and a little time to sort out my life. It would only have been a couple of years. Yet Suzanne Kessler, entertainment attorney at Bone McAllister Norton and former in-house attorney at A&M Records and Universal Music Group, said while George Michael was on shaky legal ground, he still deserves sympathy. There are two sides to this tale, she said. The music business is a relationship business and he was uneasy with what was happening. A label often wants an artist to continue to trade on their established brand with the public. But after Faith, Michael was trying for a new direction, to be taken more seriously as an artist instead of just as a pop star sex symbol. From his point of view, it was a tough pill to swallow that the label was making more money off of him than he was making. The parallel today is with subscription streaming services and other digital music where the artist is still not making what they would consider a fair return. Deborah Wagnon, an associate professor at Middle Tennessee State University specializing in music industry legal issues, actually interned in London at Russell's, George Michael's entertainment law firm, in the mid-1990s. She said the case should never have gone to court. It was horrifically unnecessary what happened. George Michael did not have the law on his side, she said. Perhaps he had justice and an ethics argument on his side, but the time to raise his objections would have been up front before he entered into an agreement with full representation. She compared Michael's case to singer Kesha's ongoing attempt to break her contract with former producer Dr. Luke, on the basis of allegations that Dr. Luke had sexually assaulted and verbally abused her. As upsetting as it was, because it felt unfair, it, Michael's record deal, wasn't illegal, Wagnon said. It's a similar situation to Kesha, in that the wrong done to her was arguably, according to Kesha, of a criminal nature, but it was not in breach of the contract she signed. In his verdict on the Sony case, Lord Justice Parker was scathing about Michael's manager Rob Kahane calling him a thoroughly unreliable and untrustworthy witness. Michael fired Kahane shortly after the legal defeat. The manner in which he pursued the case was very confrontational, and going after Sony on restraint of trade was a very UK argument, said Wagnon. He was praying for a heightened level of thinking even though there had not been a legal breach. Unless Solomon is your judge, you can't count on that, she added. George Michael changed the industry over time simply by virtue of people like me teaching artists to never have a George Michael scenario happen to them. Michael's case impacted on other pop superstars. Prince, who also had legal battles, paid P. Bullich tribute to the star at the 1994 MTV Music Awards, saying, "Peace to George Michael." Mariah Carey, then a Sony artist married to the label head Tommy Mottola, told The Guardian earlier this year about Michael, "We went for a three-hour dinner, and we had a lot in common. We both had these big issues with Sony. We had quite the conversation about it. The case had a huge impact on me at the time because I realized that artists have a responsibility to themselves to be fully informed, and representatives of artists have a duty to make absolutely certain they know and understand what they are signing," said Wagnon. George Michael was a human laboratory for the power of the right of approval with respect to creative decisions, and his contract that allowed anything he turned into Sony having to be, in their view, commercially satisfactory. Legally speaking, Sony held all the cards.
Will you sell another 2-3 outside the States?
Well, you guys made $500 million.
Yeah.
In overall gross revenue.
Yeah.
$500 million.
You know, it pisses me off because let me explain why. The government stopped me from making the money. When the government came in, at that time, Murder, Inc. was doing like over $100 million in billing for like 2 years in a row. Mm. Now, I have a joint venture agreement. So if we did that, so say in 2 years we grossed $200 million. We spent $50 million to make that $200 million or something. I'm just giving ballpark numbers, yeah. But it was something like that. Okay, so it's $150 million profit. I got a 50-50 joint venture. They owe me 75. And they was about to give me, they was giving me like a check for like $65 million. And that's why the government came in. Because if you remember, they came and raided me, but I didn't go to trial for the next 2.5 years.
They held the money the whole time.
As soon as they raided me, they sent a letter to the Universal Music Group, said, if you give Irving Lorenzo $1, you're going to be his co-defendants.
So they held
because you gave him that money, of which he's helping this fucking drug dealer Supreme out. So you're gonna be his co-defendants. So they stopped me from getting probably like $50 to $60 million. Cause now what has the Universal Music Group done? Got it. We can't do nothing with you. We can't give you a dollar. Look at the letter from the government. And they hid behind that.
Well, that was a very strange situation. Because you and Supreme have been friends from way back.
Me and Supreme began our friendship around like 92, 93.
Right. And
so we've been friends for probably 10 years before this.
And I interviewed Chris Gotti, and we talked about this in depth. That Murder, Inc. was funded by, you know, essentially illegal money coming from Supreme. Is that accurate?
That's accurate as far as what?
As far as what you were charged with.
As far as what they tried to say, but right. They changed all those charges. That's not true. The government threw so many charges together just so they could get an indictment.
Okay.
So when the indictment came down, it was two charges.
What were the charges?
Money laundering.
Money laundering.
And conspiracy to money launder.
What they tried to tie you into was
bullshit.
Minuscule amounts of money way late into Supreme's career. Right. We're talking about a couple $1,000 here and there. They try to say that Supreme bankrolled Murder, Inc.
Right. And it was all bullshit. It was all bullshit what they did to me so I wouldn't help Supreme fight his case. They knew I would have gave Supreme the money for his lawyer to fight his case. So it was a chess move to destroy me and take all of my money. Okay? Everyone knows you could just... Any idiot, forget the government, but any idiot could do the research and you could see how my rise. I was I put out Mike Geronimo. Gone in Success, got a deal with TVT. Signed Cash Money Click. Kept it going. No huge success. Got to Def Jam. Exploded. Mm-hmm. Worked with Rockefeller before Def Jam and helped Rockefeller explode, which helps me look like I'm a brain. I get to Def Jam. I'm making $60,000 a year.
That's it.
I help with Rockefeller and Jay-Z. I signed DMX. I signed Ja Rule. DMX sells 5 million albums. His first one, we put out another album. In the same year, sells another 5 million. I'm a part of Jay-Z's Hard Knock Life album because I did Can I Get Her, which was also on Rush Hour soundtrack. Jay-Z sells like 7 million or some catastrophic number. Rush Hour does like 4 million. So if you look at everything I'm a part of back there, I did work with Foxy Brown. She went like 1 million. We do the Belly soundtrack, 1 million. So everything I got is the Midas touch.
Yeah.
Like thing. They offer me a label deal. I get like $5 million. It's not Preem. Preem has nothing to do with none of this shit. The only thing he has to do with it is he's my friend.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hi, I'm Jim DeRogatis, blogger and critic here at WBEZ, co-host of Sound Opinions. And I want to introduce a project that we've been working on for a couple of months called The Kelly Conversations. It is pegged to R. Kelly, the most successful R&B star Chicago's ever produced, headlining the Pitchfork Music Festival on its closing night, Sunday. I've written a lot as a reporter and a journalist and a critic about R. Kelly throughout my career. And it's probably pretty well known where I'm coming from on this project.
I just wanted to come back with my opinions and my thoughts. You know, as you look at those clips, and it's like, it's more, like, way more. Even with Michael and, you know, different things that went on with him and Sony, as far as trying to, you know, blackball him and, you know, try to sabotage his name where he's with no money so he can end up selling, you know, some of his publishing back to Sony. I mean, doesn't that sound familiar? You know, with Robert, he had to, you know, sell some of his publishing, you know, back to Sony. And we have George Michael, his situation with them, and you have Prince. They actually went in and bought, you know, a lot of his, you know, catalog, and they're gonna launch this in 2021. And so, you know, just looking at Sony, I'm like, these people have a lot to lose or gain with these people. And sometimes it just makes you wonder, and, you know, you just start scratching your head and wondering, like, are they a part of the end for these people? You know, we got, you know, drugs and, you know, deaths like that. I mean, and if you look at the four of these people, you have Michael Jackson, you have George Michael, you have Prince, and then more. Drugs, overdose. You know, I mean, just, I know drugs are very heavy in the industry, you know, but hey, they falling like flies with Sony. And so we know, you know, Robert doesn't do drugs, so it makes you wonder, we can't take him out. Now, this is my opinion, you guys. So we can't take him out like this. So we're going to have to throw these allegations on him and make it stick. And we are going to use the government, and we're going to use the little fishes in the pond. because we know that they are money hungry, they're thirsty, and they would do anything for money. I want to talk about Miss Tap and Trap Queen, but I'm gonna say that for another day. She just needs to be talked about all by herself. We have associates, we have friends, so-called friends, and this man's not paying attention, you know, to his surroundings, Robert Sylvester Kelly. We had Michael, he was really cautious and trying to, you know, be careful of his surroundings, and he ended up got, okay? So, in this industry, you have to be very, very careful and all eyes on everyone and not trust not one damn person. In this case, you don't even trust your mama, okay? Because we see with Sweetie Pie, her son killing the nephew. We see with the rapper in Chicago, his brother shot and killed him, okay? Cold-blooded. So I'm like, hell, if it's this damn raw, family will kill you for money. Just imagine thirsty-ass people like Azriel, her pappy, and the rest of them will go out the way. I have a lot to say, you know, and this is how it boils down, you guys. And you might not want to, you know, hear it that way, but I'm just going to break it down. RICO. And I said this before. I said this last year. RICO. They had to have some kind of way to be able to try to win this case with Robert and railroad him. What's the perfect way to put a RICO charge on him? And I'm going to break this down to you. And yes, this is my opinion, but I'll put it like this. I guarantee you, the feds, because we already know that Azriel is money hungry, and a money hungry, thirsty ass person, just like her damn dad. And so they got to keep up this lifestyle. And like I said, you know, with the RICO and what people would do for money. So, RICO, a lot of people probably wonder, RICO, like, why is this the RICO? Okay, did you not know RICO, and I said this last year, you know, even when I put up the information about the blindfold law with New York, because what they're actually doing here, I'm going to get to that in a minute. So, but let me continue to talk about these women and a lot of people that's trying to jump into this indictment. The RICO, they seized all your assets, right? They try to drain you. They try to take every dime from you that you have. So, in some ways, it's probably good that he doesn't have, you know, a certain amount of money or wealth like that, because they're going to try to take it all. So, I guarantee you, and this is my opinion once again, I guarantee you this. After they held Robert down and, you know, and holding, you know, dad was in, the feds got in Papa's ear, and Papa, you know, got in Azriel's ear and explained to her, hey, he don't have any money, he broke, but they holding this money. Okay, I need you to talk to the feds. I need you to talk to them, okay? Because they got to win this case. In order to win, when they win this case, you can go back and retrieve money for a civil suit. So, of course, they don't give a damn about Robert. She don't give a damn about Robert. And the rest of them doesn't, okay? So, you see people that's trying to, you know, throw themselves in there. Okay, so I see the feds, you know, and this is my opinion, but I'll just say guarantee you that the feds are
you know, in these people's ear, you know, okay, if you're a victim and, you know, and y'all cooperate, you know, y'all get monetary gain. You know, that's why we seize assets so we can, you know, pay money to the victims and so we can retrieve, you know, our money that we lost from the government for handling this case. Okay, and you pay attention to the prosecutor. She's throwing stuff to his defense team that is not even, you know, relevant for the case for them to go through. And it's like they're throwing, you know, distractions to the defense team, you know, to take them away from, you know, doing things that they need to do. So, like, once, like I said before, I feel like they should hire, you know, some interns to go in the law firm and go over, you know, different things to help speed it along, because the more eyes, the better. And, you know, assign each intern to, you know, a device. Is anything on this device that make any sense, or, you know, with the or is it contained to this trial, or you know, things like that. So that's what I feel like with the, you know, his attorneys. But Angelo got in his daughter's ear along with his friend on the skyscraper to convince her, hey, he has no money, he's broke, they're holding his money, and that money's gonna go to alleged victims, and you don't want to miss out on it. So the feds talking to her, hey, we need you to do this and we need you to do that. That's why her name to me now, her nickname is Tap Queen and Trap Queen, okay? Because she is money thirsty like the rest of them. I guarantee you, they set her down, the feds, because she knew exactly who to call when she sat her ass on that bed and recorded that with Shabazz. She knew exactly who to call. She's been working with them for a while. Asriel started, if you pay attention to the, you know, documents, when these people stopped calling her, she started calling them back. The feds probably like, we need more. We need more. Okay, call them back and, you know, and get us more. And, oh, I'm willing to do this for money. I'll do this for money. So, you know, you see she's willing to do any and everything for money. So, this lady has no heart because it's all about the money for her. And it might be all about the money for the rest of them, because I'm pretty sure they got in Landfair's ear as well. You know, she's filing bankruptcy, you know. This can help you out, you know. We need your cooperation. We need you to help us, you know, win this case, you know, because you got monetary gain. So everything is about money here, you guys. Everything is about money. Okay? Everything is about money. And with me, I'm owning a business. I wouldn't take Asriel or anybody like Jaronda and try to have them to promote anything for me, because I don't like a trap queen or tap king queen around me at all. She went straight into Robert's house and started recording. When you start recording everything, you came in with an agenda. You already had an agenda. When she tried to get Robert to switch visitations with Joy, she had an agenda because she wanted to be able to record. So they're allowing her to record, you know, conversation with Robert inside of that damn jail. Once again, when I talked about the paperwork that they get walked into the MCC to give Robert, with him not knowing any better, like,
I don't, you know, he's not knowing any better about, you know, how it works with the paperwork. And how do he know? How does he know that you supposed to, the people supposed to look through all of, you know, open it up and read it? You know, you got somebody coming in as an attorney or pretending like they are an attorney. That was a trap. I keep telling you guys, the government needs to do a thorough investigation on this case with the feds and everybody else that's involved with this case. Somebody needs to come in and do a thorough investigation. So, with the phone, you know, I can see one of the guards telling him, okay, you know, they still on the phone. You can come on and use this phone. You can use the office phone. That's okay. You can use the office phone. And he bites into bait. That's the thing with Robert. He is easy to bite the bait. And people around him be like, no, dude, no. These MFers need to get the F on because they are messing up your life. I don't care. You know, it might hurt your feelings, and you might think that it's hurting their feelings, but they'll get over it, and you will, too. Get rid of those MFs, you know. You know, one of his friends told him, you know, done. Leave their ass at this hotel. Leave them a little money. Leave their ass at this hotel and tell their damn parents to come pick them up because they're a bunch of trouble, and they're causing you nothing but a bunch of grief, okay? A bunch of damn grief. You have this one mold, and she is like the queen bee of the beehive. So at the same time, you know, at the same time, I've been thorough. Like, you, if you want to put yourself through this bullshit with these damn women that didn't bring anything in but some ass, can't even clean a freaking house. They can't even clean your house, dude. Get their ass out of here. They causing too much racket. Their parents. They mad at you now because you don't want to deal with them with no damn business deal, because that's why they put their daughters in here to bait you. Maybe if he date my daughter, you know, I can get everything that I want. I can get my deals that I want. You know, and I know a lot of people wonder, like, where have I been? And I'll just be like this. I'm going to just be honest with you guys. They trying to shut me up. They are trying to shut me up, but you're not going to shut me up. You're not going to silence me. I'm not going to be silenced. No way or no how. I will be buried next to my mother before you silence me. And I want you to know that. And they know that. You're not going to silence me. You're not going to take away my rights. You're not going to do that. So if you pay attention to everything, even, you know, God bless Robert's soul, which, I mean, I guess the cell doors are open so they can go in and out. But during a pandemic, I thought maybe they had the damn, you know, everybody on lockdown, because they did. So I'm going to just say it like this, you know, about the rally. You got the attention, but you have people still trying to figure out the chant. What does it mean? Why are you marching for him? Why do you think he deserves due process? Okay, so now you got the attention of the media. You got the attention of them. You have the attention of the media. You have, you know, the shade room and different things like that. And, you know, I've been on the outside looking in, checking out things, doing things behind the scene. Because at the same time, Are you a fake supporter, like the fake friends and the fake associates, and you just trying to be a part of something, to have something to do? Or to have a conversation with men? You know, this is an opportunity because I'm lonely. You know, let me you know, get in this and send them information. Let me call them and tell them about this information so I can be able to have a conversation with a man. And see, and that's the reason why I really have not been on here, because I'm going to keep it 100 and I'm going to start keeping it 100. So the rally opened some eyes and things like that. So go up on the Shade Room, you guys. Find some good videos. Copy and paste that shit up on there. Tell them, check this out. Y'all might not know this, but this is what's going on with Jeronda Pace. This is going on with Azriel Clary. This is going on with her pappy and her family. This is what's going on in the YouTube streets, and they trying to railroad us and shut us the fuck up, but we're not gonna shut up. Explain to them why they working so hard if they got evidence, and this evidence is so concrete. Why are they trying to, you know, railroad everybody? Let them know why you said, where are the parents? Because the reason why I'm saying this, and I'm just gonna keep it real, I had, you know, people from New York call me. I spoke to a client, very educated people. That's like, okay, I see the thing, but what are they talking about? So I had to just explain to them, you know, if these women were underage, why nobody's holding the parents responsible? Where are the parents at? Why you don't have them in there talking and to them? Okay, why you allow your 17-year-old to go with a stranger? Because when I went to the first rally and I had grown-ass kids with me, right? And I felt responsible for them, and they weren't going anywhere without me. Okay, they wasn't getting on no bus, or I wasn't gonna get on a bus and leave them in a car or driving by themselves. We stay together. I'm like, oh no, we good. When I felt like my kids was a little in harm's way, grown ass kids, okay, a parent gonna still be a freaking parent. They're gonna make sure that their kids are okay. Okay, whether they're a baby or adults, okay? So these people, and like I said, that video is coming. It is really coming, because I'm gonna break this shit down. And I don't, at this point, because y'all tried to silence me, I'm just gonna say what's on my mind. I've been trying to, like, keep everything, you know, smooth. But if a person is doing something and they doing it, they just doing it. Okay? So you have to let them know. Okay, do y'all not know Angelo Clary has always been a part of his daughter's life? Do you not know, which the video will be coming up, that Angelo Clary and his wife claimed that they were back, somebody was with her at all times when she was 17 years old, and they claimed that they were there? Then you break it down. You have to break it down and explain to them, okay, how did some fans sit in Trump Tower and was able to wait on R. Kelly and was able to get his attention when he came in? So ask yourself, if your daughter was freaking kidnapped or you was worried about your daughter, wouldn't you sit there and wait on Robert? If your child was somewhere locked up and mistreated, you're gonna be like, hey, R. Kelly, what's up, dude? We hearing things about our daughter. We want to go up there and check on her. come on out here. We're going to the car. Sit in this car with us and tell us what's going on. Is something going on? Is he doing this? Is he doing that to you? Well, you're going to come with us. You will kidnap your daughter, okay? You do the kidnap your daughter. It's just so much that y'all can go up under. Like even the, you have the mainstream media posting things and they have a comment section. I kid you, out of all the people that are claiming that they're for Robert, I think I've probably seen 10 people go up under there and explain what they're doing. The women need to be a little more vocal, because at the same time, this is women that we're dealing with here. And let them know, like, when they hear from a woman, women of all different backgrounds on why they feel that he deserves due process, and explain to them in different ways, they will see it a little better, you know, from a woman, because we know how women do. We know how a woman will go and be conniving. Speaking from a woman's, you know, point of view. Okay? But it's a lie I can say. I'm just finna get off here and just wait on the next video. Because I feel like the feds got in Tap and Trap Queen's ear and told her, we need you to help us win this case. So she's going to do everything that she can. So just pay attention to everything. Like the last motion, right? These prosecutors are saying that his associate now, his ex-associate, said that they knew one of the jurors, okay? Okay, so be it. But then you say his counselor advised him to stay away because he overheard it, or she overheard it, and say, hey, you do not try to contact these jurors. But counselors during... When you have a case and you're going through trial and you have a jury, they're going to advise you that anyway. Make sure you stay away from the jurors. Don't go in contact with any jurors. If you see one coming, go the other damn way. If you see one at the grocery store and they in there, go to another grocery store. And that's what they advise you. So you have to pay attention to what they're doing and how they're trying to throw it. Even with this protest. And I'm going to tell you how I feel about that as well. This protest, and they didn't lock it down. The last protest, the protest before this last one. Me, deep in my soul, and I feel this deep in my soul. You had a bunch of people that was against this rally called that MCC building and told those people a bunch of lies. I guarantee you that. Why would they lock it down when the last protest, the protest before that was peaceful? That protest was peaceful. So why? And I feel like they're pulling a Khalifa, you guys. You have some dirty guards. I'm telling you, you have some dirty feds. Believe me, and dirty prosecutors. I feel a Khalifa going on. We don't know if they irked those that guy up to go and do some harm to Robert. Shake him up. You know, shake him up so he can plea. You know, scare him up a little bit. They was beating, Khalifa was in there 3 years just waiting on a trial, and they was beating the shit out of him. The guards, the prisoners, beating the shit out of this man, and he still did not plead. And this is something that's a tactic that they do. So I'm telling you guys, like, that, and this is my opinion, and looking at everything and seeing how it's playing out and how these prosecutors putting stuff in documents and stuff, and how they playing games with the defense team, how they decide they want to lock it down. But they couldn't do too much at MCC because it was on lockdown due to the corona pandemic. But I'm just letting them know. I want y'all to know I'm going to end this. I'm not going to be silenced. You can't shut me up for pointing out the lies from the truth. Are you crazy? Are you crazy? You're not going to do it. You're not going to silence me. I refuse to be silenced. I'm not going to let you. I see too much going on here that's wrong. And like I said, I'm going to treat it just like that was my son. And I'm going to let Miss Flowers tell y'all how I feel right now. Y'all have a good one. Have a blessed one. Let's pray for each other. Let's continue this fight. I'm not talking about the fake ones. I'm talking about the real ones, because I'm not dealing with no fake ones anymore.
Senator, you need to stop.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't. What the hell are you going to do? Shoot me?
Senator.
Do what the hell you want to do. Go ahead. But you can't silence me. But you are not going to silence me.